keep your signs down during the speech. It lets everyone have a chance to look at the candidate. Jack Hatch, of course, is a state senator. He has served in the Iowa House for 8 years and then 12 years as a state senator. His opponent is the incumbent Republican governor, Terry Branstad. State Senator Hatch.
Thank you. Thank you, Carol, and thank all of you for coming. I want to introduce my wife, Sonia, who's over here. And I want to thank the Des Moines Register for providing us this opportunity. I want to bring you back several years when my mother was at the Iowa State Fair. She said she had a bucket list, and one of her requirements was to come to the Iowa State Fair. So I said, come on over, come on down. She said she wants to bring her granddaughter, so my niece came with her. But I didn't understand why she really wanted to come until she asked me to make sure I got tickets for Dolly Parton. So we came to the fair for the day. We saw the show. The last time I was on the Ferris wheel was many years ago. My niece wanted to do it again and again, and I couldn't walk, so I said, no, I'm dizzy, you go on your own. Well, we had a great time, and I know Iowans come here all the time, many years, to have a great time at the Iowa State Fair. That brings me to another story about my mom and why I actually came to Iowa. You see, she was an educator, and in third grade, I was still reading first grade books. And I had trouble reading throughout my whole career in education. She knew something was wrong. She and Dad kept on reading to me. I was tutored, went to summer school. She called it perceptually handicapped. But all the time, she worked with me, and we got through it, and that challenge was overcome. But you know it today as dyslexia. And so when I talk about early childhood education, my support for universal childhood education is not because the data shows it, the research shows it. It's not because teachers want it. It's not because parents want it. It's really because I'm a product of early intervention. And being a person that had an educator for a mother, I could tell you with certainty that if it wasn't for that early intervention, I wouldn't be here ahead of you, in front of you, as a Democratic candidate for governor. It's because I had an educator that intervened in my life who taught me how to overcome the challenges of dyslexia. And forever, I will be. That's why not only will we have early childhood education, but Governor Branstad, in his first 2 years, tried to defund all the funding for voluntary childhood education. And with me, we won't have to worry about defunding it or lowering the expectations or the funding. Will be fully funded for universal childhood education. And we're not going to give up on the 16, 17, or 18-year-olds either. You know, in this state, as in many states, there's a age limit in which a student could leave high school. Well, why do we want to have 16 and 17 and 18-year-olds leave high school and join a pool of adults? 40,000 Iowans that don't have a GED or a high school education. And they are ill-prepared for the jobs of the future. So in my administration, we're not going to give up on 16, 17, and 18-year-olds. We're going to keep them in school. We're going to make sure that there's a school and a learning environment in which they can succeed in. And when they graduate, they will have more options. And they will be able to fill the job shortage of this state with an education and job skills that will make their lives better. It will increase the middle class and maintain the economic security that our families need in this state. And we're not going to stop with just high school graduation rates climbing or new job skills for adults. We're going to make education in colleges much more affordable. Today, a college student is leaving this state with the third highest debt in the country. That is not the Iowa way. That is not the leadership of our state. We're going to work hard at getting that debt down. We're going to work hard at getting options more available for students so they can graduate faster, earlier, and with less debt. So that will be another promise I will give you. And then when we talk about jobs, you know, the governor said last week that we're the seventh lowest state in unemployment in the country. And he's right, we are. But what he didn't tell you was that in January 2011, when he came into this office, we were the fifth lowest state with unemployment. Our economy is recovering slower than the rest of the country, and we can't afford that. We can't afford an economic policy that's going to reward undeserving corporations by giving great economic incentives and tax breaks to large out-of-state corporations that only bring in the lowest and fewest amount of jobs. Now, what we'll end up doing is reversing his strategy. Instead of keeping all the money in Des Moines and rewarding winners and losers and having private secret meetings with corporations and making the deals before they know what they've even done, we're going to decentralize the Department of Economic Authority and make it local. We're going to create regional authorities so people in the area who know where the jobs are, what the jobs need to be, what the educational and training requirements are, we're going to allow them to apply for tax incentives and state assistance and let them decide, not people in Des Moines, but people locally decide how we're going to create jobs and do it the real way. And then, of course, I think it's appropriate at the Iowa State Fair to talk about agricultural production, water quality, and the best thing we could do to make sure that our farmers and ranchers maintain the profit that they need and the security that they want is to make sure that we have topsoil that they can farm and clean water that we can drink. You know, we're not going to pit big corporations against consumers anymore. That's the old way of doing it. We're going to show the leadership and pull together all the stakeholders, just like we did with mental health reform and health care reform and education. We're going to bring all the stakeholders together, treat nobody special, and then understand that until we get that consensus, until we understand what it is that Iowa would lose if we don't act now and take seriously the loss of topsoil, the loss of clean water, and the extreme conditions that affect all of Iowa and all of production. In a hatch, we will never be able to assure the security for our kids. And I just want to say one other thing about how we're going to create a better environment for business. When I chose a lieutenant governor candidate, I chose Monica Vernon from Cedar Rapids. Some of you know her. I got to know Monica right after the 2008 Great Flood that devastated all of Iowa. She dug in with her colleagues and made a choice. Cedar Rapids could either slide and be forgotten as a city, or it could rebuild, which it did. And just last month, the mayor of Cedar Rapids, Ron Corbett, a colleague of mine in the Iowa House years ago, came back with one of the few cherished awards that's presented to cities in this state or in this country. And that cherished award was a designation as Cedar Rapids as an all-American city because they rebuilt. They knew what they had to do. And right now, Cedar Rapids is one shining example of what we have to do and want to do as a state. Monica will lead that effort in making sure that local communities can compete for job creation, working with community colleges, businesses, all the stakeholders. And I'm real proud to have Monica on the team. So what I want to promise everybody, as politicians normally do, but it's a concept and it's a vision, that I want Iowans to earn more. I want Iowans to dream big. And I want Iowans to move forward. So under our administration, we will play by the rules, we will earn more money, and we will dream big dreams not only for our children, but for ourselves and for our seniors. Thank you very much.